everyone. Welcome to my next essay on Vincente Minnelli, the director. This is on the heels of the other essays I've been doing on Westerns, in which I now have a tripod, so the camera is going to look a lot less ugly. Vincente Minnelli has a special place to me because I sort of grew up on him without knowing it. Only until about 17, when I saw that AFI list of the great movies, was I aware that there was, that I got into classic film. Before that, I just watched whatever was at the theater, and I had a mother who had a collection of films like, but she had very niche interests. She liked Alec Guinness, she liked Cary Grant, she liked Alfred Hitchcock, and she liked Gene Kelly. So much so that I didn't even know there was a guy named Fred Astaire until well into college. Vincente Minnelli, what I didn't know about Gene Kelly was that Gene Kelly was part of a musical factory called the Arthur Freed Unit of MGM Studios. And MGM, which their motto was More Stars in the Sky, produced musicals ranging from Broadway Melody to On the Town to Annie Get Your Gun. I believe they might have done The Sound of Music. They also did Singing in the Rain. They did just tons of stuff, including, and many of these, like Meet Me in St. Louis and American in Paris, were the work of the great Vincente Minnelli. So he had a great deal of impact on their blueprint. Let's look at one of his most famous films. This is Meet Me in St. Louis, which came out in 1944 during the war, and this was part of an effort Hollywood did in conjunction with the War Department to produce films that showed homespun Americana, and nothing more homespun Americana than the plot of this film, which is about a family in the middle of the turn of the century, 1903 and 1904 in St. Louis, getting excited about the World's Fair coming to their town, and all the young woman, like the Judy Garland character here, is in a rush to get married, get all that. This, Judy Garland actually is amazing in this film. She's best known for Wizard of Oz and I think some other stuff from the 1930s. Then she got into a drug problem. Before that, she really grew up in this film. This was kind of the first film that gave her an adult character. And this musical number, we'll pause it, that's her crush in the film. And now she's gonna sing, and it's amazing. But before we do that, let's just pause it just a wee bit more. Judy Garland in this film is, this number is one of the first integrated musical numbers ever in movies. Before this, musicals were sung in a backstage format, meaning that it was an actor singing because they were supposed to sing, like 42nd Street, or... earlier in this very musical, Meet Me in St. Louis, a family gathers around to sing Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, if I'm not mistaken. In this case, the characters are singing as a natural expression of their communication, and the audience gradually suspends their disbelief. She was well known for Somewhere Over the Rainbow, but I say screw Somewhere Over the Rainbow. She's amazing here. I'm going to turn up the volume a little bit. Now she's singing about her crush. So that's just so amazing. She's so great in that, partially because she's acting and singing at the same time. She does so much gestures, and part of the integration was integrating acting and singing. This is a ridiculous movie called Brigadoon. It's one of his lesser-known movies. but it takes place in 19th century, 18th century Scotland, sort of 19th century Scotland, so really. But this is the classic standard. It's almost like being in love, which is a classic jazz standard. So anytime you're at like an old people's party or a cocktail party or a wedding or maybe a bar mitzvah, you might hear this song. It's almost like being in love, which originated in this movie. A lot of these little movies, like Anything You Can Do, I Can Do Better, or How About You, some of these songs have originated from MGM's song catalog. And this is the great Gene Kelly. When I was a kid, I thought he was the only person ever to sing and dance in history, because I didn't know anyone else. And Gene Kelly was... He loved ballet. One of his goals was to masculinize and popularize ballet and to combine it with athleticism. But that is more Gene Kelly's doing. Gene Kelly did this in films that Vincente Minnelli didn't direct. But Vincente Minnelli was a painter and a set designer. He was born to a theatrical family in Chicago in 1903, which gave him connections to a musical theater where he signed on as a costume and set designer. And you can see this great attention to detail in this set, which is supposed to be Scotland, a Scottish town from the 1700s that sleeps 200 years and wakes up in the 1900s because of like the most ridiculous plot flammery. But it's okay. I'm okay with that. It's a great movie. And there's two actual oxes and a pig. And I have seen this many times because I'm pretty exhaustingly doing lots of takes on this. And these are some great animals. And I originally had some jokes, but I can't remember what I was going to say about those animals. But I do believe they're real. Another thing I just want to briefly mention is that a lot of his films, he wanted to shoot on location. I do remember this, that Vincente Minnelli, in his biography, he regrets not shooting Brigadoon on location, but the studio didn't want to do it, too much money, so he recreated Scotland on a backlot, which I think is more impressive. And at the back end is just a painting. It's, you know, he could probably just run through that wall like Roger Rabbit if he wanted to. It's just a painted backdrop. It's a two-dimensional backdrop. You see that cloud isn't moving in the sky. You're not fooling us, Vincente Minnelli, but it's totally cool. Let's talk about the next film. And by the way, this video is complimentary of amuggle15. That's the YouTube user who uploaded this, so thank you so much, sir. Or ma'am, whoever you are. My next film is from 1955. I watched this when I was a kid and thought this film was amazing. And when I first learned that there was a list of classic movies called, like, the 100 best films of all time, I personally wondered why this wasn't on it, because I thought this was the best film ever as a kid. It's called Kismet. And one thing I think that's Howard Keel, who might have had a chance of being the next Gene Kelly. He was in 5 movies for MGM, also Showboat and Annie Get Your Gun, and he kind of regretted they didn't use him enough. To star in 5 movies that survived the test of time, I think is amazing, but, you know, whatever. This is one of the stars of the film commenting later in post-production about how great of a film this is and how you should watch this film. This is the trailer to the film. So, I think the thing to mention here is that Kismet takes place in that era of Arabian literature when The Thousand and One Nights and Aladdin and Thief of Baghdad was produced. It's a rich story, and it takes place in 8th century Baghdad. We've seen 18th century Scotland. We've seen Scotland, St. Louis at the turn of the World's Fair. All of these things take you to exotic places and times. And as a kid, I felt extremely transported by these films. You know, the narration in these 1950s movies is always telling you, we present you an exciting and exuberant screen. They musical show. They just tell and rather show the trailer. Another thing about these MGM musicals is they had a lot of organic music. This song is called Baubles, Bangles, and Beads, and she's just singing about what's great about the glories of this market. I feel like a lot of musicals today would just put a lot of generic love songs, like The Greatest Showman was guilty of doing that, or aspirational songs, just so that people would, the tracks would be timeless, but here the tracks are very specific. By the way, my battery's low, so at any time this take could drop out. Not since Jericho started sliding, we belong here. That's really great. And this is the main number, the like proverbial Can You Feel the Love Tonight for Lion King or A Whole New World for Aladdin. This is Stranger in Paradise, which was actually published in 1890 by Alexander Borodin as part of an opera that was co-opted, I'm not sure how the legal department did this, for this 1955 musical. And let us move on to An American Paris, which is one of his three or four most famous films. It's a classic. It's also on those lists of 100 best movies ever made or whatever. It won an Oscar for Best Picture. And as you can see, this is another painting. This is Gene Kelly just dancing away because Gene Kelly loves to dance. And this is Vincente Minnelli really taking the artistic spectrum to a new level. This is not supposed to be realistic. It's just supposed to be artsy, you know. If you recognize the music as of a famous composer named George Gershwin, you're onto something. Just like they co-opted that opera, they decided to co-opt to sort of create something out of a popular piece of music that wasn't written specifically for this musical. The opera or ballet or song, I don't know what you call it, the musical composition American in Paris. And it's really, it's done very well here. But there's more. Gene Kelly and Vincente Minnelli and Ira Gershwin, George Gershwin's surviving brother and the holder of his estate, as well as his lyricist, decided to make perhaps the first ever jukebox musical to George Gershwin and his music. So let us go to a little bit of a scene, because again, this focuses on the exotic, and I want to talk about how the exotic focuses into the plot. So let's look at American in Paris, the trailer.
We believe that each and every...
Oh, and, well, because I'm not, like, you know, super rich and can pay for the ad-stream version of YouTube. But while these 9 seconds are going on, do you know that Vincente Minnelli was the father of Liza Minnelli, who you sometimes see in the tabloids and was on Arrested Development and Cabaret? Interesting fact for you. Okay, let's get to American in Paris. So this is Gene Kelly. I want to talk about. This is basically the plot. It's not the guy gets Gene Kelly's character Jerry Mulligan gets caught up into a love triangle, but other than that, it's basically a guy just enjoying himself being in Paris, and then I guess sort of seeing if the reality of his dream is as good as it would be without a woman in his life, or you know, a little bit of conflict. But the love triangle is not very intense. And it's a very, and when you think about it, the plot itself is just as escapist as the scenery. To a certain extent, Vincente Minnelli, the exoticness of his plots taking you to far off places and times is part of the appeal, but the plot itself lends it to that because it's a guy who himself wants to escape. Also notable is the guy is a painter himself. Now let's talk about another film. We know that Vincente Minnelli, he was a painter, and he liked to characterize painter characters, and he didn't only direct musicals. He directed the comedy Father of the Bride, and he also directed this film, Lust for Life, about Vincent van Gogh, which was about a painter, but this is, look at the music, it's very dramatic and all kinds of things. And there is Kirk Douglas, who lived a very long life.
Few people know the real story of this intense...
And again, this is absolutely nothing like a dainty musical. It's a very intense thing, and that's Anthony Quinn in the background, who won an Oscar for this, as the painter Paul Gauguin. I probably pronounced that wrong. But this is a much darker tone that Vincente Minnelli was able to experiment with. I think he, I'm guessing he was probably attracted to this. I believe he might have had some inner turmoil.
Let me talk to Kay for as long as I can keep my hand in this flame.
See, it's a darker, it's dark and dramatic, but I also feel like the tone, the visual tone, Anthony Quinn, there he is, he's doing some acting. And look at this blue and orange palette here. That's actually, a lot of filmmakers love doing blue and orange in their palettes. For some reason, I'm not sure, there's a technical reason for it. I know Pacific Rim was big on it, as were the Star Trek, the J.J. Abrams series. And there's, you know, the framing itself is really exquisite in this. And that's sort of the Vincente Minnelli trademark. There is also important, he also did the film Sandpiper, which is another film of inner turmoil, which is, I guess, how dramas go. And I think if you look at this, there's a lot of painterly landscapes in this. This film starred Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, and they were like a forbidden couple. They like wrecked a couple, they wrecked their own marriages by, you know, canoodling with each other, or that, you know, when they shouldn't have been on the set of another movie. And this is an amazing, shot. And that's kind of showing Vincent Minnelli's penchant. Is this not a painting? Is this not a painting that's just inserted into a movie? But anyway, these two were canoodling on the set of another movie in Cleopatra. That was the name of the other movie they were making. So the public had a fascination in seeing what they would do when they actually acted together. And that, I think, sort of would have driven the movie. And look at that again. There's oranges in the background. It's like a still life.
A man to really love a woman like me.
But there's Elizabeth Taylor if you ever want to see what she acted, what it looked like to see Elizabeth Taylor act.
I still don't know much about your attitude towards marriage.
How's yours? Adequate, as they say.
I'm afraid not. It's more than adequate. It's good.
So again, Vincente Minnelli had some range. This was the period during MGM when he, I think right around 1965, he no longer was part of the studio system because the studio system fell apart, but part of his work, like Father of the Bride and The Bad and the Beautiful and The Sandpiper, was part of the MGM, so he probably was ordered to or decided to take other assignments that weren't necessarily musicals, which were his bread and butter. But either way, he had some versatility to him. Now, just for fun, I'm going to look at a movie trailer of a film I have not seen. This is Gigi, which won him his second Oscar. He won for American in Paris. He also won for Gigi. And we also have a commercial. The YouTube gods are not smiling on me during this take. Let's just pretend that he directed this Dead Sea Mineral commercial. That this is Vincente Minnelli's, like, lost. It was lost in the Vincente Minnelli archives. All right, this is the film Gigi. Now, at any point, my battery's running low, so this might die out. And I'm not doing another take, because I've done 20 already. So this is Alan J. Lerner and Frederick Lowe. Initially, I didn't know who they were, but I Googled it. And they also wrote the soundtrack to My Fair Lady. So they guess they love doing soundtracks to upper-class, middle-class stuff. They also did Brigadoon, Almost Like Being in Love, which you heard earlier, is by them. So this guy sounds like Pepe Le Pew. Way too much like Pepe Le Pew. And he's singing a song called Thank Heaven for Little Girls, which is really creepy. And he needs to tone down that accent, we know that.
She was so eager, so young, but not too young to learn about making herself shine in the eyes of some lucky man.
We don't marry, said it. Instead of getting married at once.
Okay, so she's a vehicle for marriage. I'm not sure if she's being engineered to be jailbait.
She was raised to raise eyebrows.
Raised to raise eyebrows, that's a little fishy, but I don't know, whatever floats your boat in 1958.